holy manna is our bread, come from wilderness and wandering, here in truth we will be fed. You that yearn for days of fullness, all around us is our food. Taste and see the grace eternal, taste and see that God is good.
Good morning, and welcome to worship with Mount Zion United Methodist Church and Scottsville United Methodist Church. We are very delighted to have you with us on this beautiful spring day. We've had a busy week, busy couple of weeks actually, and I want to send a special thank you out to all the trustees and the church members who have been working really hard getting our church and our parsonage ready for the new pastor coming in July. We look forward to taking the next step forward. Now let's settle our hearts and center on our worship.
Thank you, Sharon, and good morning, children of God. So good to have you worshiping with us on this, the fifth Sunday of Eastertide. And as we have been doing throughout this season of Easter, we begin with that ancient cry of the church. He is risen. He is risen indeed. He is risen. He is risen indeed. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. As we prepare to worship, I would remind you that this being the first Sunday of the month, we will be celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion. Once again, during this time of pandemic, we're privileged to be able to extend the table of our Lord from our sanctuaries into your homes. We invite you who are worshiping with us online to share in this holy meal by gathering some bread or some crackers and some grape juice or water in advance of our worship. Let us prepare to worship. And let us begin by hearing these words inviting us to worship from Psalm 22, verses 25 through 31. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. I invite you to join us as we continue in our worship by singing the hymn, We Know That Christ Is Raised. It's number 610 in the United Methodist Hymnal. Let us sing together.
Return to blazing door.
Let us pray. This world I live in, this town I live in, this street I live in, this house I live in, may each be the focus of my prayer. Those I live with, those I rub shoulders with, those I work with, those I don't get along with, may each be the focus of my prayer. Those who laugh, those who cry, those who hurt, those who hide, may each be the focus of my prayer. Prayers centered less on self and more on others, less on my circumstances, more on the needs of others. May my life be likewise centered less on self and more on you, and through you to the world in which I live and move. In silence, let us continue to offer our prayers to God. Amen.
Our scripture lesson this morning is taken from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this way, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also.
Our gospel lesson is from the Gospel according to John, chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. I invite you to listen for the word of the Lord. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we seek to abide in you this day. We pray that you will abide in our hearts and speak to us this day. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Last Sunday, our daughter Margaret and James were married. That day marked the beginning of a new phase of their journey together. Certainly, it was not the beginning of their relationship, and we all prayed that their love that already existed would continue to blossom and grow and mature. But then on Monday, the movers arrived at Margaret's condominium to move her furniture to James's house. That process is well underway that will transform what was James's house into their home. And as part of this process, Margaret and James both will be changed, and will be changed by the place where Margaret now lives. And she will, in turn, help to shape the home of which she now is a part. I can look back now and see how such a change has taken place in the almost 45 years of marriage that Carol and I have shared. We sometimes talk about the symbolism of a unity candle. Carol and I each entered into our marriage as separate individuals, but yet, in another sense, we became united as one. We retain our individuality, but we surrender a part of our individuality to the unity of our love together. Living in our love has shaped our lives. And that's not simply the effect of the aging process. Many of the changes that I've experienced in life have resulted from living in love, or may I say, abiding in love with Carol. The scripture lessons that we read this morning both speak about abiding in love. Our culture has focused so much on the sentimental, the sensual, the romantic aspects of love, that I'm afraid we've lost our connection with the spiritual nature of love. Not only the spirituality of love between spouses, but also the love in which we are invited to live, to remain, to abide. Yet this message of love is central to the gospel of resurrection that we celebrate during this season of Eastertide and that we celebrate throughout the whole year. During the next several weeks, I'd like to focus more on the nature of this love in which we are invited to live. Love is the radical message of the gospel. Listen again to these words from 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. And then later on, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. There is a dual nature to love. First of all, love is a verb. We are told to love one another. Our relationship with God is revealed in the way that we love. And I don't see any exception given to this command to love. We are to love, period. I can try to excuse my failure to love, but 1 John is unyielding. He says, those who say, I love God and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they've seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. This commandment to love isn't just a commandment to exercise sentimental notions that overlook our differences. That commandment to love does not mean that we will always get along with everyone. Jesus tells us, though, that we are to love our enemies, to pray for those who persecute us, so that we may be children of our Father in heaven. The commandment to love does not mean that we won't stand up for what we believe. The commandment to love does not mean that we won't have a backbone of our own. But the commandment of love does mean that we will see each other as children of God, beloved by God. It means that sometimes we will live in tension as we try to understand and live out what it means to love someone who does not love us in return. Love is a verb. But love is also a noun, because 1 John tells us that God is love. We see many different portraits of God in the scriptures. We see a God of power, a God of creation, and yes, we even sometimes see a God of judgment, but we always see a God of love. You see, the God who made us loves us and wants us to share in God's love forever. That means that God wants us to share in Himself. Jesus invites us to abide in Him. What does it mean to abide in Jesus? It means to abide in, to remain in, to live in love. And when we live in love, we live in God. This is a statement that is both mystical but yet eminently practical. You see, our love is not a matter of sentimentality, but in the words of the Apostle Paul, love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. When we live in love with God and in love with our neighbor, we will see, we will trust, we will hope, and we will endure differently. This type of loving takes time. It takes time to develop. I want to love, But sometimes I fail. But we continue to grow in love until we mature in our loving. This is what it means when 1 John says that we are to be perfected in love. That phrase, perfected in love, doesn't mean that we will never fail or fall short. Rather, it means that we will develop and grow in the way that we were made. We will mature in loving, just as a tiny rosebud will mature and grow as it is perfected in what it was meant to become. In this way, love is a way of seeing. The way we see those around us and the world in which we live, this way of seeing will be transformed and changed. The mystic Thomas Merton writes about the transformation that took place in his own life. He writes these words. In Louisville, at the corner of 4th and Walnut, in the center of a shopping district, I was suddenly overwhelmed with the realization that I loved all those people, that they were mine and I theirs, that we could not be alien to one another, even though we were total strangers. It was like waking from a dream of separateness, of spurious self-isolation in a special world, the world of renunciation and supposed holiness. The whole illusion of a separate holy existence is a dream. There is no way of telling people that they are all walking around shining like the sun. But it was if suddenly I saw the secret beauty of their hearts, the depths of their hearts, whether neither sin nor desire nor self-knowledge can reach the core of their reality, the person that each one is in God's eyes. Merton says, if only they could see themselves as they really are. If only we could see each other that way all of the time. But this cannot be seen, but only believed and understood by a peculiar gift. That was Merton's description of his own transformation, of being transformed into seeing people shining like the sun. We cannot love in this way on our own. We only can love by recognizing the love that God has demonstrated toward us. We love because God first loved us. And as we live in that love that is God, God shapes us. God enables us to let go of our own egoic needs to control, to grasp, to take hold. And God transforms us to give, to yield, to share. All too often, we blame our failure to love on people and events outside of ourselves. Sometimes even blaming God Himself. We say, I can't help it. God made me this way. But as writer Bob Goff says, all of those excuses may simply be a means of stalling. When someone says they're waiting on God, really they're just stalling. When we say we're waiting on God, God is really waiting on us. Bob Goff goes on to say, if we're waiting on God to find out whether or not we should live a little more like Jesus, don't waste any more time. The answer is yes. We are invited to love now. As Easter people, We are not here simply to believe certain things. And we're not here simply to wait until we gain something in the future. We are here to proclaim the good news that Christ lives in us and shapes us and transforms us. The real question is not where do we live, but who lives in us. I invite you to let your life be shaped by the one who lives and moves and abides in us until you too can say, "It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." May it be so. Amen. Loving and gracious God, can it be true that you want to live in us? Can it be true that we can live in union with you? This is so amazing. But when I'm honest, I admit that it's scary at the same time. For it would mean giving up so much of what I want and then desiring what you want. I can't get there on my own. I pray, O God, that you will take over the control of my life and heart so that all of us can live and move and find our being through you. I pray that you will take over our loving so that we can see all around us your children shining like the sun. Help us to love as you love. Open our hearts so that you are loving through us. We lift up to you those who are on our hearts this day. We pray this day for Genevia, who is in the hospital on a ventilator with walking pneumonia and COVID. We pray for the family and friends of Kenyon Heyman, who passed away on April 23rd. We give thanks for the love of Margaret Tobat and James Tobat and pray for their lives together. We lift up Coda, the 11-month-old baby boy. We pray for Drew and his mother, Carolyn, for Bev Butler, Kevin Cunningham, Joe Espino, Bob Harper, Agnes Johnson, Ken Mata Morris, Christopher Pasco, Ginny Haney, John Smith, Bob Srigley, Ruby Willis, and those we now name in our hearts. Lord, we also lift up Laura Stratton as she prepares to move to the Scottsville area and take on the role of pastor to the churches of Mount Zion and Scottsville. We pray for the healing of our nation. We pray for all afflicted by COVID-19. And we pray for an end to this pandemic. Into your loving hands, O God, we place all for whom we pray, trusting in your infinite mercy and steadfast love. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who repent of their sin and seek to lead a godly life. We invite you to gather together some bread or crackers, some juice or water, and prepare to participate with us in sharing the real presence of Christ. Come to the table. The Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity to sin and death and set before us a new way of living, a new way of loving. And so, with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew into a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, But now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, our Lord took a loaf of bread. He gave thanks to you, and then he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, all of you. This is my body, which is broken for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." And that same night, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this cup, do it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, with confidence, as children of God, let us pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The bread which we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? And the cup over which we give thanks, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? Friends, this is not the table of Scottsville Church or Mount Zion Church. It's not a United Methodist table, but this is the table of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ himself invites you and all who earnestly repent of their sins to come and seek his real presence living and abiding in you. We invite you to share in this presence during our singing of our closing hymn. May you too experience Christ's presence abiding in you. As we close our time of worship together, my hope and prayer for you this day is that you will discover that source of love living within you, and you will allow yourself to be an instrument of God's love to everyone you meet. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you and love through you, now and forever. Amen.
Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together in love.
Go in peace.